Welcome to Hash Time with Navguzi Chiwanuka. This is a place where we help you unravel social constructs, discuss self-development in line with mental health, emotional well-being, and everything in between that directly or indirectly affects us in the millennial world around us. If you're hearing my voice for the first time and are the kind of person who is not scared of being a better version of yourself, even if it requires you to contradict who you were 24 hours ago, consider this your virtual home. I'm your host, Navguzi Chiwanuka, and I cannot wait to engage with you in the various conversations. For our launch of the May episodes, we have Jombwe Jeff Jephthah. He is the kind of artist whose unwavering decision to pursue art started at an early age. Most of us were barely sure of what we would be as adults. Jombwe believes that for one to reach exceptional heights of recognition, talent should go hand in hand with hard work. He brings to us many gems in this episode, so without further ado, let's get into it. Jombwe Jeff.
Yes.
Jephthah. Triple J. What is that thing they used to say in math? Cubicle.
J cubed.
Welcome to Hash Time with Navguzi Chiwanuka.
Thank you for having me.
What did you anticipate when I invited you?
I'd say talking about my life.
Oh yeah?
Having a conversation, getting to know each other, and also sharing a few things.
Yeah, you're not getting to know each other. You're not going to ask me questions on the podcast.
No.
This is your moment to shine. You're going to shine your shine.
Definitely have to shine.
Let us know about who Jombwe is.
Ha, that's complicated. Jombwe. The easiest explanation would be a creative with a busy mind.
A creative with a busy mind?
Yeah.
How busy is your mind?
The kind that gets bored easily. So it's moving from one place to another. Today you're thinking about the sun, the next time you think about the moon, and all of a sudden you think about the stars, then you're asking yourself, why don't snakes have hands or something like that? Like, it's a whole...
friend, how are we going to be able to beat their heads? If they had hands, you know when you want to strike its head and it holds it, like, hey.
Oh, it walks away. It's like, no, not today.
Not today. Wow. And what more do we have to know about Jombwe?
Jombwe loves art. The other thing is cooking.
Yeah. What food are you cooking, Jombwe?
Basic.
What is basic?
It's basic cooking, but then you're interested in learning and failing.
What have you mastered so far?
It took me about 3 years to learn how to make chapatis. The right way to make chapatis.
What is the right way? Are you looking at shape?
Shape.
The shape doesn't matter, it's the test.
No. A chapati in the form of Uganda, map of Uganda, no thank you.
It's the test.
Yeah, sure.
It's about the test.
The shape too.
The test matters.
Have you ever had a round samosa?
I would love that. I think that would be a pie. Thinking of it, I feel like pies are just samosas in a different shape. That's a lie. You keep telling lies to us.
No, but like for chapatis, it took me around 3 years to learn the right way.
Is it consistently or was it just randomly?
No,
that's a long time.
It's like after 3 years that I learned, it was something so simple. You had to let the dough rest after kneading. I would always knead, roll it in two balls and start frying, and then they would always be hard.
Yeah, I've made some chapatis that are like, you know, breaking bread in church. But it's nice.
Mine felt like a plate. You spend all that time to make a plate. Nah. After that,
so they got softer. You think you're sure it's just about letting the dough rest for it to be softer?
Yeah.
To give it time for reaction.
Yeah,
and
like
all
you
those
let
things.
You let the gluten in it to form or relax. Because if you to knead it then then and you start frying, like it will not have that.
So you're a professional when it comes to making chapati. Is that what you're saying?
Not a pro. I will not call myself up because that sets you up for not learning more. It'd be like, I'm good enough. So that in case someone has a new recipe, you're like,
they don't trust
I can
you.
Try it out.
Okay.
Yeah. So you leave room for improvement.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
One more is there about Jombwe.
Jombwe. He lives a lot in his head.
Oh, yeah. You gossip. You're the people that gossip. On your own. You like, see that one now.
Yeah, gossiping on my own. No. Then he loves. He just loves humor.
Oh, my goodness. Jokes, I can't keep up with you sometimes. I'm like, okay, no, that was not called for. Like the time when you're talking about things like, are you using a microphone to record this audio note? I'm like, oh my God, what are you talking about?
No, because there are some voices that are just perfect for a podcast. Uh-huh. And the people who are hosting do not know the quality of the voices they are using. They do not know that people normally listen to you because the good content aside, uh-huh, they go for the voice. They're like, it's the kind of voice I would want to listen to.
Oh, yeah.
So if you're to get a job as a radio host, you'll be like, she deserved it.
They're saying radio doesn't pay.
Hmm?
There's no money. Shati, people are broke.
You know,
someone said people are broken radio. Actually, they're going for free drinks because they work for radio stations.
It depends on the impact you have, maybe. Because some people have those shows whereby you touch the souls of some people. Like, your job is to comfort. Someone approaches you like, I listened to this and this and my life has changed. Not these things of, hey, we go party, what? No.
Yeah.
There are those shows whereby someone listens to you and they're like, every time I want to sleep, I just tune into your show and I'm good to go.
As a love of arts, how did you come to that place? Is it something that you always wanted to do growing up?
Growing up, I think in primary, I always wanted to become a vet. I loved animals.
Whoa!
I loved animals.
I didn't know such thing when I was a child.
At the same time, it was a unique profession.
Did you already know that they were in existence?
Vets, yeah. Because me and my dad loved watching National Geographic, stuff to do with animals, snakes, what.
National Geographic was there in primary?
Yeah.
Or more, you come from a rich family, my friend. First, we're watching UBC.
No, we had access to DVDs. You know those DVDs they sell of animals? Let me say, like.
So you were buying DVDs?
Yeah.
No, they were not DVDs.
They were like collections. You know, like collections.
They were in primary, they were tapes. Video tapes.
No, before that.
DVDs.
It was after, like around my late primary. That's where they were trained.
And you were buying DVDs, animals.
My dad would get them because he loved animals and stuff.
Wow.
We have like a whole collection of videos to do with documentaries about snakes, gorillas, sharks. Like, then from then I was like,
is he doing that? Is his line of business with animals?
No, he actually bakes cakes.
Oh my goodness.
Mm-hmm. I think that's where my love for cooking came from.
From him being the baker?
Yeah. Although the trigger for me going into cooking was my eldest sis would leave me with our niece, the firstborn. I was like, yeah, there is a kid. I provided everything, figure it out. She'll give us the basics. They're like, if you don't learn how to cook, the kid is going to starve. So you have to step up. And from then on, at first it was a burden. I'm like, how many cups do you need to make rice? Like, why is it so complicated? 2 cups, you need 1 cup. I'm like, no.
Yeah.
Then all of a sudden, like, I became interested, and I would thank her for that. Like, she introduced me to cooking.
Oh, she got you the skills of surviving on your own.
Yeah.
People have a problem. When I say people, I'm mostly addressing some men. I've had a conversation with some guys before, and one of them was like, I think one or two of them were like, it would cause them some kind of embarrassment if they are found in the kitchen, yet they have women in the house.
That would be, I think that's like, I don't know, it's a funny way to look at it to them. I think maybe because they didn't grow up with a dad that would literally cook. My dad would literally cook supper, would cook lunch, like it was a normal thing. So it didn't feel like a gender role. It feels like a survival skill like everyone should have.
Yeah. So it wasn't really a surprising thing that dad was cooking?
Not really. Because he was exceptional at it.
Was he exceptional, or was it because it was not an everyday thing for him to cook?
It was not like an everyday thing, like maybe like for a man. But then when they do it and they are passionate and the way they do it is good, you're like, that's mind-blowing. You're like, I didn't know that they would be this interested.
Because I feel like when you made mention of how exceptional he is, I remembered my eldest brother, because it was mom mostly cooking.
Mm.
So on the days when my eldest brother would cook, I would praise the food from the first spoon to the end. I'm like, Ronnie. Like, and then I don't know what mom would think in that moment, but I'd praise him from the first spoon to the very end. And I don't think he was cooking. And I can't tell now because that time I was young. Of course, I don't think he was cooking better than mom. Mom would give me the food, I would just eat. But if it was him, Ronnie.
I think for moms, if at all it's a mom doing it, it feels like a chore.
Something they're supposed to do?
Yeah, it does not feel like I'm passionate. Yeah? They know a certain way, like it becomes the norm, like beans do this and this. There's nothing, there is no twist added.
Yeah.
That's why when you find chefs that are guys and stuff like that, like their food tend to taste better than
what is that so?
What you are used to, because like it, they go from, they have to go past the stereotype to be able to learn.
They need to impress.
Yeah. You have to, it becomes like a passion. Because you may ask something like, how do you do this? I just know. But when you ask a guy like, what do you do this? And they'll go to the details of, you put in this and this and this and this. Like, but with this one, be like, just put in, you just put in that. It just feels like, it's the same thing with kids finding their father's fun compared to the moms. Yet they actually spend more time with the mom.
Oh,
they spend more time with their mom, and the mom is more of like, Rose, do this, do that. Like, they have a certain way a kid is supposed to
be. And there is someone who's breaking the norms.
The dad comes in and is like, yo, let's play with the sofa or something.
Let me hold you upside down.
Pillow fight, and like, or when mom says, don't do that. The dad will be like, let the kid go and touch the fire to find out. But it's like, no, don't hurt my baby. But like, that one mistake will teach the kid that's hot.
Yeah.
So like, there's that balance of, dads are the fun ones, moms, because moms do it because it's like a default. They can't help it. They're like in autopilot. But for the guy, he comes in, the mom is already tired.
Yeah.
This one, okay, steals the mom's glory of, you've spent all this time with that thing, you look tired, there's a reason for being tired, and then this one comes in, daddy, and like, but you spent all that time with your mom. She has had an entire buffet of breast milk for you, and you still can't notice that she did a lot compared to daddy.
Man.
They're always too.
Come from this one and you go to the other one.
They may be vanilla this side, chocolate that side, or strawberry. And then when daddy comes in, steals the thunder of the mom.
Daddy, so we have you as an artist. We have seen you. I think Facebook mostly experiences you in painting and the chibi. I don't know if chibi falls under the category of painting. But I've seen you do, I don't know what that is. You call it doodling?
Yeah, doodling.
The doodling that I experienced in S1 is not what you're doing.
Okay.
The way they were making
that,
us do
that
stuff.
That felt like free kind of doodling. I think it was more of, you're not really being yourself.
Where? In S, like senior one?
Yeah. You're not being more of yourself. Like, they start putting all these rules, add color, add what. You're trying to impress.
Trust me, to date, I don't understand what I was doing. It doesn't make sense.
They are trying to make us.
I don't even remember the rules.
They are trying to make us loosen up. At the same time, they felt like you felt like there are certain ways supposed to do it. Once you attach marks to something, because you're like, why did this person get 100 and I get 80? Yet I was just expressing myself.
So when now I'm going to take you back to your S1 because it feels like you're very much in awareness of what's happening. Were they telling you that you were having a free expression of self?
It felt like that, but at the same time, it felt like you're trying to do it towards getting a better grade.
So it was more like, yeah, do something.
Do what you want, but make sure I like it. That kind of like, they're like, you're free to do whatever you want, but make sure you're in line with what I want. So
it doesn't make sense.
It kills. Once you attach, it's doodling. You're expressing yourself. Why would they, the moment they attach a mark to it, you're now telling someone else that your freedom is not that impressive to me.
Oh, you're right. Yeah. Right.
So like some would lose out on that interest. Later on, they just drop the subject because it didn't feel free.
You know, I had never thought about doodling until right now, like the doodling that I experienced in S1. And I was like, wait, what was that? Like, put next telling us mix colors, manya, put here and then choose your colors. I don't think
that makes sense. Come in and guide you.
I don't think
through
that makes
your
sense.
Own creation and like.
I don't think that made sense. Just
but the doodling I do right now,
yeah,
I try to do it in such a way that you show people that anyone can do it.
Is there a particular complexity attached to doodling? It's something that a simple person cannot do?
I think the complexity is how to be simple.
Oh.
That's the complex bit, because you would have someone doodle with just a white pen and I'm okay with that. But to someone else, I'd be like, let me add a little bit of pink. Let me add a little bit of... And now that kills the whole thing of simplicity.
Yeah.
So like if I'm to do it in such a simple way, it looks complex to you because I've eliminated so many things that would have crowded the thing. So when you look at it, you're like, wow. Yet if you are to do the same thing, you're going to put in, you're going to use a pen, you're going to use a marker, but I've only used one pen and I'm good to go. So that's what makes it look complex. Yet anyone can do it. And you get
anyone.
Better.
Anyone.
Anyone. Anyone. It's not an artistic. Like
is
by
that
default,
so?
By default, we are artists. Ooh. From a very, very tender age.
Ooh.
From a very tender. Didn't you use crayons as a kid?
I don't know about that.
Drawing mommy, daddy, like
I'm
it was
not
like
very
the most.
Sure, but I had colors. I don't remember if I had crayons, but I had colors.
It was like the most basic way of expressing what we are thinking.
Mm.
When you leave the school bit aside,
yeah,
kids
normally
communicate through those artworks, those simple. Because like, if you're to push anyone to continue with that every day, you look like as if you are talented. That's where the talent bit of you're talented is a myth. It's a myth. It's like
you look like you're talented.
Yeah, no, every time I see it, like you're so talented. It's like someone is degrading the
so
hard
are you
work.
Talented?
I would say I put in plenty of hard work to get where I am.
But talent doesn't mean that you're not putting in the work though.
To people that are not artists, they see it as a compliment.
They feel like it's automatic that you're supposed to do that? Is that what you feel?
No,
like?
That's not the... I don't think that's what they are trying to express. But to the artist, it feels like you are born good. And yet, if you're to think of it like, if this person is really talented, why is their artwork from 10 years ago different from their artwork right now? Like, what causes that?
Right.
Yeah? It's improvement. But to someone like, you're so good. It's like they use the talent bit of putting you on a pedestal without them putting in the hard work to become as good as you are. It's like, an excuse they create to be like, ah, you're exception, I can't try what you're doing.
Oh, yeah.
Yet anyone can be good at art.
I don't believe that part of
anyone. Trust
me. Let me tell you something. I won't tell a person's name, but I joined senior five in a different school. And we were figuring out who's doing what. The thing keeps playing me. Combination. I keep saying course. Who is doing what course? Combination. Sorry. And we had some people that joined the art class. And this chick drew something. I think they had told us to draw an imagination.
Imaginary composition.
Yeah. And she literally drew stick woman. Like, a bigger stick version that possibly has not just one stick, but like a kathai, you can see a kathai.
Oh, like an obese stick figure.
Maybe.
Like you, instead of drawing with branches, you're using the entire tree to draw that.
I was defeated. Like, I don't remember. I think I laughed, but... But I was like, what are you doing? I couldn't find what she was doing. Like, I couldn't believe she was in the art class. Because there was nothing. You said that's why I'm sort of not agreeing with you to the point, to the thing of everyone is talented. At some point she left. I think she noticed that it wasn't meant for her. The class was not really a good thing for her. So she had to choose another subject.
Because speaking of the talent bits, like, you've seen that style of mine of Bolongoto.
Yeah.
I created that technique to show other people that really art is literally what you make it.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say it is talent, it means you have a certain high expectation of what good art should be. So anyone that is trying or starting out will feel like, nah, they not good enough.
Personally, I don't feel so good enough when it comes to...
Your drawings.
Yeah,
you posted some drawings.
I am an artist. I keep telling people I am naturally an artist because that's something I've been doing from childhood. But I don't practice. That is something that usually eats me up. Like the guilt really grips me most times. But there are some works that you see and you're like, hey, I'm not an artist. Like, you do not want to even offend the artist practicing. Like, no, I can't stand up and tell people that I'm an artist because I can't do what some other person does. On the beat of you talking about the Volongoto, I feel like it requires an artist to know how to do the Volongoto as well.
The challenge with the Volongoto is more so with an artist that can do the kind of things that people consider talented. The challenge with that is you have to ignore all the good things you know and think like a child.
Is that possible?
That's how the Volongoto starts. You have to think like a child. That's why the Volongoto relates to people. Like, when you look at it, you can't tell this was done by an artist. It looks like a kid.
Are you sure?
It looks like a kid did this. Because you see the way I draw the noses, it's not how I normally draw my noses.
But I think I don't, maybe it's because I already know it's Jeff's work.
That's where a bias comes in. But if someone else is to look at the thing and they're like, no, a kid normally draws like, the challenge with it is like, you have to ignore all that you know. To think like a child, like, you remember,
I don't think I would know how to think like a child.
No, that's where the challenge would come in.
I don't think I'd know how to think
because
like
with
a
that
child.
You ignore the bit of it has to look pretty.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you say that you're trying to go away from the best version of yourself that you are well aware of.
Yeah.
Reminds me of Johnny Drill. One time came to Facebook and he was like, I'm going to do a bad song because you guys don't think I can do a bad song. And friend, I think he forgot that he was doing a bad song. Because I'm like, are you serious, Johnny Drill? I think you forgot.
Like it was a good bad song.
And then at the end he was like, I think now you can believe that. I was like, are you serious? You failed to do the bad job. You failed to sing poorly. So I feel like it's still something that is very easy to walk away from. When it's an artist, like those things that I don't understand, I don't know what the name is for that form of art. However crooked, should I call it a composition? However crooked a composition is, you can still tell. Personally, I can still tell this is work of an artist.
Oh, you mean like you're referring to abstract art?
Yeah, abstract or whatever.
That art has some patterns.
You've talked about you wanting to have been a vet. How did you veer into art?
I actually switched up. Actually selected the vet thing partly because it was a unique profession. No other kid was mentioning it. No other kid was mentioning it because everyone is like, I want to be a doctor, a lawyer. Yeah, you're like a vet. I'm like, that's specific. It's under being a doctor, but you're specific.
Yeah, a doctor for animals. Oh yeah, and you feel cool.
Yeah. I would feel cool. Like,
How long did that dream last?
It was, I think, around P2, P3. That's when
you already had that.
Yeah, it was P1, P2. That's where I wanted to be. That's what I wanted to be like. Yeah.
Then what made you change your mind?
I think you'd start noticing that you'd be exceptional in class. You are drawn to, every time it was time for, like, let me say, science class and stuff, you're drawing diagrams, you're so interested in that drawing bit. Like, you, when you draw, like, other people can't see why you're excited to draw those things. They're like, for me, just do this. Like, you go the extra mile.
Mm-hmm.
And later on, you'd have girls coming, hey, help me draw, help me draw.
Yeah, girls. Like, so the boys wouldn't come to you.
No. Boys would have their egos. Like, what would that guy help? Like, I'd rather fail. I don't have my freedom to fail.
Freedom to fail.
Mm. Then in S1, there's a guy, I think he's called, he was called, I'm trying to remember the name.
Was he a teacher or a fellow student?
A fellow student. He was the house prefect. Our house prefect was in S6, I was in S1. Then it was MDD, time for MDD. And we were in the houses. The house, I've remembered. The house, he was called Wemba Bazipo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And he's like, I think the reason I became an artist, because that day, I remember we were like, before actually the MDD teacher came in and stuff, the guy drew Dexter on the blackboard from his head, like with chalk. And it was the exact Dexter. I was like, how do you do that? It's like
Dexter.
Yeah. From his head, the exact guy on the blackboard. And that was like, whoa, I want to do that. We became friends there and then.
He was in a class higher than yours?
He was in S6, I was in S1.
Okay.
And we became friends. I'm actually one of the few people that would be allowed to go to the S6 wing, because back then it was a no-go zone. I would go there and inquire, how do you do this? And how?
So it was always an arts consultation?
Yeah. I was just interested. Every time you'd see him somewhere, be like, let me have a look. From then on, I was like, I want to be able to draw a cartoon from my head. Like, that was the goal.
Wow.
Started practicing. Look at those cartoons in newspapers, try to copy how they are. Like, keep on pushing. Then there was another one, his friend as well, he was called Danzi. Because now I think he's working by NBS marketing. Danzi Dijan. He was exceptional.
Yeah.
I think he's like the best artist I've ever seen, like in physical form. He was too good. Too good. No, most that I look up to are online. But like, this guy was really, really good. Pastels, what, imaginative poems, like, it's like he would literally photograph the scene in his head and the way it is.
Wow.
He was that good. I went to his room because I think back then he would do posters for like the entertainment club for movies that are going to be shown during what?
So he would create posters?
No, he would, let me say, like you copy, like you're going to watch Harry Potter, right. You go get the Harry Potter thing, copy it, then display it so people know like, eh, this is what I would, what we are going to watch.
Ah. I was like, yeah.
Like even your expression says it, you still believe, like you still bow down, like, okay, that guy.
Sometimes if I were to meet him and I had like 200 million on my account, I'll just be like, take it. Thank you. Like that's how much of an impact those two guys were in my life.
So and then, that was you in senior one?
Yeah, that was me in senior one. I was like, I want to be an artist.
Had you heard of any artists making money out of it? Because why I'm asking you this is because when we go to school, we're definitely looking for ways of making money as adults.
Yeah.
So when you talked about you wanting to be an artist, was it something that you had seen somewhere? Something that you felt like, I've seen an artist, therefore I can actually be an artist as well?
I looked at it, not, I didn't look at the money side of things way back. I looked at that excitement of creating something from out of the blue that drove me like, sit down, scribble a cartoon and like put in color and like, oh, from my head. And then later on you go on learning different things. Then I was interested in the, you know, that calligraphy on birthday cards.
I was making money from that. Hey, these guys that want to write themselves about the messages. Friend, you give me a break. Now I'm doing things for free. I'm doing things for exposure.
I actually was around S3 when I was really into the calligraphy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Then I would start making cards for my friends.
Oh.
Most of them actually were girls. Like, and you know that excitement, like when you do a card and they're like, oh wow, like they start screaming and blah blah blah. You get like a hug. No, I was not used to hugs. It was Jeff.
Mm-hmm.
No, like you'd get a hug, and to me, hugs were strange. It was something new. So every time you'd, I think they didn't know why I was actually doing the cards to some extent. Now I'm confessing. You're looking forward to that hug. And you target those people that you think may give the best.
At the end of last month, we launched an online store for all of us to be able to access our podcast merchandise. The podcast is run on a freemium model, and that means that I do not charge you at all to have access to the podcast conversations. But because I have a few running costs and the goal to acquire a podcast studio, you can support the podcast by purchasing one or even all the merchandise available. Check out the show notes for the link to the store, and if your podcast does not show you the hyperlink, check out our social media pages for the link to the store. Let's get back into the conversation.
So you put in your time, you do. No.
Because too early.
It was a win-win. You get
you
the get card.
Hug,
I
hug.
Get the hug. We're good to go. And then, like, the cards kept on improving. They were so good, and the strange bit was, oh, still. They are cards. Imagine I've made a birthday card for you and someone steals it. It literally has everything to do with you. But because it's so pretty, someone steals it.
What were you using to create these cards?
I would be given pocket money. Like they started giving me money for shopping. Like around S2, they would give you money for shopping. But then you have this dream of art that you have to fund. You take off half of your shopping, you'd be like, I'm going to buy art supplies.
No.
I'll take half. I would always buy paint, buy paper, buy calligraphy pens. Around S2, S3 there.
Wow.
And go with them to school to make those exceptional cards for my friends and stuff like
and
that.
And get hugs, imagine.
Yeah. And later on, those hugs and the cards and the happiness led to a business.
Okay.
Now people would be like, I would need a card for my friend.
Ah.
Time for sex for like exams. You'd be the one making custom cards for friends.
Mm. Okay. that makes sense.
So you didn't picture the bit of making money, but then you create this thing out of love that you become good at it in to the extent of someone wants to pay you.
Right.
And then that starts. It reminds me of the first portrait I did. I was paid 5,000. I was like, wow.
5,000 were you at that time?
I think it was S3.
Maybe if people gave me money, I would have stayed an artist.
No, it changes you.
I think.
Even if it's just 1K.
Personally, it felt like something I'm doing in my free time. I had never looked at it as something that I could do as an adult. And no one even inspired me to do that. I didn't even see an adult do that, you know? So even when it came to choice of, you know, subjects, people were alarmed, like, you're not doing art. I'm like, yeah, I'm not. Like, for me, it's not something to study. It's something I've been doing outside class, so I can still continue doing it. And I felt extremely guilty. I think must have been last year. I was at court and I saw a chick I studied with, I think in S1 and S2. And her first question when she saw me, she was like, do you still draw? That was a slap in the face. I felt so guilty because already the guilt is eating me up. So if I was exposed to arts in the form of making money, maybe if someone asked me, I would say I wanted to be an artist, but man, there's no money coming out of it.
Well, for me, like, the money thing was like a plus, but then I just went into this tunnel vision of, I'm hearing so many people telling me that this won't work out. Why won't it work out?
Were they telling you that?
That's some relative, that literally told me there is no money in that. But I was like,
oh yeah, that was after them asking that what was you like, wanted to be.
Those ends in primary when they literally told me that, but I was like,
primary.
Yeah.
That was early.
I was like, I wanted to be an artist, blah blah blah. Like around P7, P6 there.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be an artist. I want to do what? And then they throw that bomb on you. There is no money in this. They try to bombard you with those ideas of what a successful life is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they wish the best for you, but then at some point, sometimes you have to let someone risk it all. Let them fail when they're in charge of those failures, other than succeeding when they owe that pressure to someone else. Like, it will not be fun. Like, be like,
yeah.
Because I have a friend, 2 years into medical school, he quit.
2 years into medical school?
Yeah, he quit. The pressure was too much and he didn't feel like he belonged. He felt like he was trying to fulfill someone else's dream.
Right.
And the moment he decided to do that, like, he got backlash and all that. We are still on the path of him starting out and getting back all that lost time. Because to the parents, I think they felt like, this is the holy grail. My son should be a doctor. Uh-huh. And they bombard you. They make you feel special as long as you are in line with their dreams.
Yesterday, last night, someone was, I was at a poetry event and someone said that it's interesting how some people become successful because of some other people's success. And then that's where we were starting to talk about things like, parents coming out and saying, my daughter is a lawyer. Instantly they become successful because you're also successful. My daughter is a doctor. And then they can't come out and say, my son is an artist. Right side eyeing you like, yeah, what is that? So wasn't there a moment where you felt like, maybe this is not the right thing?
No. I've never been that focused in my life.
What do you mean you've never been that focused?
Like, people actually would be envious. They would be like, you know what you want. Even when I would flip, let me say, like, chemistry, you fail at, you're like, I know this may not work out. I know the end goal. I literally told my economics teacher, he was on my case, like, yeah, hey, you're failing. I'm like, I'm sorry, I may not be that good via exams. I may fail your subject, but I know I'm going to be an artist. That's what I want.
Wow.
That's what I want. I told him, like, every time they would come to class, the class was full of artwork.
So you would do the artwork and then pin it up?
I would always have artworks, like works that you would want to put in an exhibition. That class felt like an exhibition, and would get lots of awards, like those class thingies whereby they check out and start rating classes. My class was full of artworks. I would literally, like, let me say, like, over the weekend,
mm-hmm.
on a Friday, because the next day you're not going to have class that early. It's actually optional. I would stay in class drawing, painting. S5, S6, and I would, if at all I'm too
that to is delay, serious.
I would sleep on a desk. Because by then, by the time you go back, it's too late. You find the boy's end closed.
Oh, they would close that off?
Yeah, they would just close for security purposes. So I would just end up like stay painting, and it became such a routine that even the askaris themselves would respect my time while I'm up late. They're like, hey, where is to you? Hey, where are you painting? Like,
wow.
It became like a norm, like in the morning you then after you go back to the dormitory and feel like, yeah, I've created something. It was
you were in school, we used to call that banging winter. Have you heard of that word?
Yeah, I would do it. I would do it.
So you were banging winter for art?
Yeah. But I wouldn't do it for other things. No. And morning preps were the worst, because I had sinuses and I still have migraines to this day, like more so in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
So that time I would just sleep. I would just rest. Morning.
Did you ever have some sort of family intervention?
The only intervention I got was
to tell you, man, you know, life is beyond art. You need to do something different.
I think my mom was looking out for me, because at the time she was in the UK and blah blah blah. But then she had that bit of, she's not sure, but she believes in you because she wants the best for you, and she sees how happy and focused you are towards art. So she would send me those expensive paints, sketchbooks, but she was still doubting until that I started making money, and then she was like, shh. he's on the path.
When did you start making money out of art?
I started making it in, I think it was SD, through the cards.
Oh.
Through the cards.
How much were you charging at that time?
It was like around, for a high-end one, it would be like 5,000.
Hey, man, that's high.
Yeah. And they were not ordinary cards. You know those cards whereby you open and things are in layers, like they pop up. Like, I actually had to, during holidays, I would sit down and study how those things are created.
Wow.
And during those times whereby you get like a computer free, you'd run to the computer lab and while other people are playing solitaire and about GTA or what, you learn, you're getting art tutorials.
No way.
That's what I would do.
Way.
Holidays, you have some extra money, you would go to the internet cafe just to learn.
Wow.
No one teaches you all that. You learn how cards are made. But right now, the cheapest I could make a card for is 50,000. A custom car, it could be 50.
Well, I do is going to buy a car at 50,000.
I get them.
Are you serious? I've never seen any of your cards.
I post them once in a while, but then those are like, they are rare cards.
Mm-hmm.
They are rare cards. There are some people who value that compared to an ordinary card that's like, let me say,
5,000. Those things are boring.
Because this is made from scratch. But I also feel like people
don't really understand the value of cards. Because there's a time when I told she's more like a sister.
Mm.
But one time, I think it was mom's birthday and she didn't have money. And I was like, just give her a card. And she was alarmed, like, that is embarrassing. How do you give an adult a card? I'm like, a card is a sentimental piece. But I don't think people really understand the value of
it. And it means a lot more when the handwriting itself is by an actual human being,
mm-hmm.
other than those generic
it gives
words.
More value,
of, yeah.
By the way,
yeah,
it does give it more value. You've been running a, should I call it a promotion? yeah, what should I call it, this much you have been giving offers, if I may,
yeah,
when it comes to creation of chibis. That's the word I've just seen from you, man. I don't think I even care to search if the word
I learned that way back in S2000.
My goodness. And I'm just hearing it for the first time.
It actually means it's a Japanese word to mean like it's like a deformed person, not deformed in a way of ugly.
Mm.
It's like, let me say, like, it's like a normal person with like a huge head, but with childlike features.
Ah.
It's like, okay, like that whole aesthetic is something that looks like a child and cute. The owl kind of art, that art, like, it's like,
oh,
that's what chibi is. It's synonymous to kawaii, another Japanese term.
Uh-huh.
But I learned from way back. I was on some site called Drago Art, where they would show you step by step how to draw, blah, blah, blah. Then there is actually, I should have actually come with that sketchbook. It's one of the most important things in my life. It's my sketchbook from S1.
Whoa!
It's one of the things
that
I got.
How many years ago is that?
I'm not so sure.
What do you mean you're not so sure?
Counting back, it might be
sounding,
like...
Why are you sounding like it's 20 years ago?
It feels like 20. It must be like 20.
It can't be 20 years ago.
Maybe like 20 or 15. But like, the reason why that's like my most important book is that every time someone looks at your work, they're like, wow, you're so talented. You bring out that book and they're like, so your work look like this from... Yeah.
Yeah, I think I would have wanted to have a look at it.
It's like my most prized possession.
It's of intrinsic value. You can't attach value to it.
No, like the best evidence of it's not talent. There's no way someone will understand until they look at that sketchbook.
Eh? It is
hard
it
until
is
when you look.
It is possible for someone to grow, to grow more into their talent.
Mm.
It is possible. I don't know why you're watering that down.
Like, it's the same thing with singing.
Maybe it's... Now, let me give you an example.
Mm.
I am talented, right? But much as I am talented, I'm not practicing, right? So that's where the difference is. So you are talented and you are practicing and you are growing your artistic side of you. So I think that's where the difference is. So don't dismiss the bit of you being talented.
I think the talent is like an interest. Then the hard work is what makes you exceptional.
Thank you so much.
But if you just praise someone in regards to just
so you want us to start saying, you are hardworking, Jeff. Mm-hmm.
No, like, you're good at what you're doing. Like, you're putting the hours. Like,
yes, talent.
The people who are better than me, I would not be like, they're talented. No. What I'm seeing is the 100 hours they have put in to be that good. I'm not seeing the times when stuff was not working out. I'm only seeing the end product. Then I'm like, wow, you're so good.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're to look at that sketchbook from S1, it was actually those promo sketchbooks they give that have the school, blah, 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 it's like a normal textbook. But when you look at that book, you'd be like, he's capable of drawing this funny. It looks like a child playing around. And when I look at a book and I'm like, what I can draw now, I'm like, yeah.
You're looking back at your growth?
I'm like, it's hard work. It's hard work.
It's in your head.
It's hard work.
Have you had a moment where your mental health was compromised?
I think that's why the art side came in.
Oh, yeah?
Mm.
Come on, we're looking at you from, like, what age are you doing art?
I had to... I realized that later on. That I think at some point my subconscious mind developed a love for art as an escape for like the social awkwardness and not being able to feel like you belong. Like you feel anxious to talk to people, then you find like the only way you can calm yourself down is through art. It's through art. Looking back, I'm like, I don't have noticed that. I may be like, yeah, I was interested, but then looking at everything that has happened in my life, you're like, this felt like an escape.
Oh, yeah?
Because while I'm doing this, they would ignore that I'm not talking to them. Or I'm quiet, they'd be like, this guy is so good.
Yeah.
Like, even sometimes some people around relatives actually will be like, okay, your son looks, talking to my mom, your son looks mean, he looks reserved, he looks what, and then when they see my artwork, they're like, oh, okay, let's talk. How are you good? I'm like, I have so much time to myself. That's why I have time to do all this. Like, then after they start talking, like, oh, he's interesting. He just doesn't talk for the sake of, well, let's talk.
It's not for wasting time.
It has to have a goal. Like, the conversation you're having here, I would have it, like, forever. Because these are things we would want to talk about. Like, these are the kind of topics I like having with people. Not those things of, how was your day? How is the sun? Mm? Do you like this?
How is the sun? It is very hot. But
what's the temperature? Do you like the humidity?
You know, I'm embarrassed to say that. I still don't understand the word humidity.
Humidity is like the amount of moisture.
So how do you say the moisture now?
No, like the thing is, there is a, is it, I think, is it a barometer? I'm not so sure.
Barometer is for pressure, I think. I think.
We don't know. We do not know. I agree with you. I was going to say Stevenson screen.
No, I don't know. I don't understand those things anymore. So there is no moment as me asking you things like, what do you do to take care of your mental health? So it's just art?
Sometimes I have different art styles that help me cool off.
Oh, they're different styles.
Yeah. Sometimes when I'm not really feeling good, I may resort to chibis, because for chibis, it's all about color, making it cute. Mm. Then also like having those multiple art forms. Eh? Sometimes you get, when you're not feeling fine, you've been drawing portraits, you switch to something else, maybe like Volongoto. Then the other calming thing would be like calligraphy. Because calligraphy, like, you do not rush it. You can't
sit for hours.
And you just, your mind is going off. But as for the mental health, it's on and off. Sometimes you're really down.
Right.
You're really down. And then the humor is like one of the biggest escapes for people who are not really fine. Because they know what it's like not to be okay, and they would not want someone else to be in a similar situation, so they would rather create that thing of everyone around can be happy and I'm okay with them being happy than them being in a similar state.
That's right.
So you're like, say, like Robin Williams, that was really funny. He was really funny, but I don't think he did it because he really wanted. He was like, by default, funny. He was having his own issues, but he didn't want other people to feel the same way. So he's like, let me offer these people what I'm struggling to get.
Yeah. I think it's powerful how you've put it, because for some period of time, I didn't know why I was always finding myself in a position of not having people feeling left out in school. But I think it's something that was coming right from my primary school. I think about my days in primary school, that is P4 to P7, and what was that, you know? So it sort of makes sense why between S1 and S4, I was always looking out for who is quiet. How about I have a conversation with them? Mm. And there was a kid who was new in the school, and she always blamed me for making her stubborn. Like, I brought her out of her shell. So the way, when you say it like that, that when sad people use humor to save the others, meanwhile they're serving them from going deep down into the deeps of depression. It does make sense.
Then at the same time, it's like a smoke screen.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if everyone is happy around, they're not going to come in and pose that awkward statement of, how are you feeling? So you have to confess what you're feeling.
Ouch.
So it's like, make everyone happy around that they will not notice that you're not.
Oh, but that's dangerous.
No, like, it's like, it's in that situation, yeah, it's dangerous. But in that situation, when someone is having mental issues, sometimes they would want you to listen and not provide solutions. Because
thank you so much.
When you provide solution, you're actually telling them, I think you're stupid.
Yeah,
you are in this situation. Yeah, like, just put on a happy face. So the people that tend to mask it off, they're like, having the right person to talk to me or to make me feel like I can talk about it is hard. So let me just make everyone happy. Because the mental side of things, like approaching, like, it's like the person is not in charge of who they are. It's like they're in airplane mode or something like that, but then everything, it's, they're like delicate. I don't know, it's hard to explain. Because in that situation, yeah, you want someone
when
to ask.
When have you been delicate?
It happens often. It happens often.
What is the most recent? When is the most recent you are delicate?
Must have been like last year. Last year, it was actually one of the toughest times. Because I worked for some client for over 2 years. I mean, 2 months, working on multiple murals and stuff like that. And when stuff is all said and done, the client starts acting funny. And I made a loss of more than 10M. More than 10M. And in that situation, you'd be the guy who would go on social media and try to expose this person. But I was like, it's not really worth it. You also take on the blame of, at some point, I ignored all the red flags.
Yeah.
I ignored the part that you're supposed to sign a contract before you proceed. I ignored the part that, why is this person ignoring you, denying you to write a contract? Like, because you are too excited.
Wait, you had asked for the contract and they dismissed the validity of
I don't think they suggested it, because I had never done a project that large. And then when this person was contacted, told me to go and work on the thing, they presented themselves as, you're working on one thing. They call you like, hey, go to this place, you're going to work on one mural. Then all of a sudden they start acting funny. They're like, hey, you thought you're going to be here for 1 day. There are multiple murals. And then that message, it's hard to keep track of. And you're in a foreign place. You're not in Kampala. You're not what? You're in a foreign place. You're relying on this person too.
You're in prison.
Yeah.
In short.
So like, your stay there is funded by this person. At the same time, they have a say. And when they want you to move to that place, to go to somewhere else, and they haven't yet paid your thing, they'll be like, I'm going to pay you. And then they create that thing of, you are slave to, they own you. And then I was like, instead of running around and trying to be like, you just take on the bit of, you take responsibility for your actions, instead of always trying to be like, hey, he was the wrong person. Be like, I too ignored the red flags. I was too excited. And you try to heal. But then that was a huge blow. Because this is someone you knew. Someone you know, like.
That's what hits us the most.
Your friends.
That is what you're hits the you
professional.
The most.
He is trying to play you and you're like, why? I've done everything like as if we are not friends, like as if you are a high-end client. That's what I've delivered.
Yeah. What was that moment like for you?
It was tough. It felt like, I don't know. It felt like rape. Like the worst kind, whereby literally have no evidence of scars, bruising, like there's no evidence that the pain is on the mind. There's no way you're going to be like, yeah, in a court of law, like, yeah, let's open his brain and see the scars to see what happened.
Right.
You just felt like, I felt stupid. You feel like you can't fight back. Like it's too big. You didn't expect it. It came in so fast that you're like, what do I do? If you go to the police and report that, because be like, why did you continue with all this but all they were not?
Oh,
they're
my
like,
goodness. Now. I know. Yeah.
But this is someone I trusted. I did everything they wanted at the time they really wanted it. Because that's one of the toughest times.
How did you manage to come out of it?
I made peace with myself. Like I realized, like, instead of dwelling so much on the amount of money I lost, I instead turned that amount of money into the cost of that lesson. If the if it's a 10, if the lesson is worth 10M, that 10M has saved you from making a loss worth 200M.
That's right.
It's like a time when I went to visit some friend of mine and they gave me a deposit. It was around 200 for a painting.
Uh-huh.
I put it in my jacket pocket and that entire amount fell out.
No.
And ever since then, I put all my money in a wallet. I put it in a wallet. That was the cost of that lesson. Imagine another time you put in 1M and it all falls because you didn't learn from the other. So like, someone asked me like, what was the most expensive lesson in your life? I was like, that, 10M.
Yeah.
10M. It was like actually the second greatest after me choosing to drop out of what? Makere.
You dropped out?
Yeah, I dropped out.
What was the reason?
It was like, at the time, mom was struggling.
Yeah.
To make ends meet. And you know how MOOC can be. It was actually that day, like Friday, and the next Monday, we are starting to do exams. And the money hadn't yet been delivered. And you know, it takes like around a week for the money to reflect. And they can't let you in without a bank statement. They can't.
Wow.
So I was stuck there and I'm like, I actually went and I talked to her. I'm like, mom, don't bother. Other kids will lie around. But I'm like, let me be that one kid that will be like, mom, it's okay. I appreciate what you've done so far, but let the remaining amount be used for my brother to finish high school, because I think he was in S5 around that time. I was like, she was like, but, I was like, nah, I'll make it. I'll literally turn this failure into a push to become better than those people that literally graduated and got the certificates, because you strive to be so good that they don't think about your documents.
Thank you.
They're like, you can do that job. Well, those who have the documents are like, I'll apply. I'll go tell them and I'm dedicated. Well, for you just be like, they go to your profile and they're like, oh, so you do this and this and this and
mm-hmm.
this. And ever since then, no one has ever asked me for a document. And the other challenge is that parents don't know the quality of education we get via the art school. They do not know. All they know is that, hey, you're going to get the certificate. But then I was the kind of person that was exposed to the internet and like, my bow has those ends. But when I went to the art school, I was like, no. You know, like wanting to drop out in orientation week.
Yeah.
Because you're looking around in the compound, there are these sculptures, because those sculptures are like what final students do like at the end of 3 years. And I'm like, at the end of 3 years, if this is what you're putting out, like, I'm doomed. I'm doomed. And I was not the kind of person that felt like, let me study and get the certificate for that case without realizing that there's a price attached to this certificate.
Mm.
You do not just go, and parents don't just pay for the sake. This is their money.
Right.
And if you're smart, you'd rather walk away, because for some people, you need to go to the university to know that you do not need it. Well, some people need to go there to realize that they need it
right,
in their career.
Right.
But I just had to have, I lucky wanted that stain in my life to push me forward. Because if I had to go and graduate and what, I would feel entitled to a job without putting in the hard work. You're like, I'm unemployed, blah, blah, blah. But I graduate, I'm like, are you putting in the hard work? And after some lecture, wanted to pay for me to finish, but I was like, if you could use that money to maybe get me a laptop or get me something that can fund or maybe like supplies to do with my art, but I was like, nah, I wanted to go and finish. I was like, that's how these guys were ingrained. This is the system. But I was like, and from way back, like I had that rebellious kind of thing of you're trying to fight the system. You're trying to be like, yeah, let me prove a point to you guys. Yeah? That's where actually the dreadlocks came in.
Oh.
Because like once I did them, my grandma had issues. They were bringing in those Bible bichi bichi, blah blah blah, and blah blah. I was actually feeding off that. I'm like, thank you for the segregation. You're actually giving me more reason to have this. Because every time someone is like, I don't know, the arch career, like you lucky have to be rebellious, because that's not a kind of career where everyone will support you. And it's worse when it comes to family. You'll be looked at as you're playing around.
That's right.
But then when you go and work on a gig and you're getting 1.5M for having done something for 4 hours, that's 4 hours.
So they start bowing down to your face.
They keep quiet. Because we are used to this mindset of sit in a cubicle, sit in a what, get your monthly salary. In my head, I'm like, the people who make the most take risks. You're in a career whereby tomorrow's money is not guaranteed.
That's right.
It's not guaranteed. I'm always on my toes. I'm always on my toes. I'm always on my toes. It fluctuates, goes on and off, on and off. But it's way better because at least you're in charge. Mm. You're not a slave to some system. Because even if you're paid 500,000 every month, like, reach a time whereby that's little, but what are you going to do? You're stuck there. They make you feel like you can't create something on your own.
What words would you want to leave for the listeners?
They should follow their dreams. Regardless of what some people might say. Sometimes, yeah, parents for the most part wish us the best. But for the most part, they're literally projecting their insecurities upon us.
Yeah.
This person couldn't become a doctor. They want you to be that doctor. And then when you become that doctor, they are proud that you became that doctor, like as if it was your effort. They're literally telling these people, I'm glad I'm a doctor through you. Without necessarily saying it. But then know that the way to the top, the people that are exceptional, you have to go past the rules.
Right. For the people that want to get in touch with you and possibly pay for your services, how would they get in touch with you?
Currently, I'm on Facebook, Jomboy Jeff. It's the easiest. Then from there, you can switch to the WhatsApp. I have the Instagram. I have an Instagram, but then that's...
I've seen it's not very active. It's I think it was last active. I don't know which month. It's not updated.
The Instagram side of things, it feels like hard work.
It feels like hard work.
It feels like hard work compared to Facebook. Like, their system requires you to be sharing work on a daily, and then at the same time, it is hard to put a face to what. Who is doing what? And it's like Facebook is like the way people can relate to you. Like, you're literally having connections with people in your country. And Instagram is like this platform with over 1 billion good artists. So by the time someone notices you, like, you're on the app 24/7. I think I've gotten one commission from there, someone interested in whatever my work. But then for the most part, I was like, let me just use it as a portfolio. You just put in like the very best of work sites, like a page someone can look at. Because like the other bits of what is expected, you have to put reels, you have to put like, it feels like hard work and you're not getting anything in return.
But there's a bit of monetization. I don't know how they do it.
It's there, but the challenge is it's, for that top thing is, and by the time you become a top thing, Instagram is like your job. It ceases, and once you get followers, like let me say 40k, your art ceases to be yours. Every time you're under pressure, without necessarily someone put it, to put out something way better than what So you're way better off having very few few followers that know what you do,
mm-hmm.
that stand by you, other than having a majority of people that are just staring in. Very few people can contribute, and then you're always under pressure to be on the app.
Yeah.
So Facebook is more like a community-based kind of, eh? It's like the real you. You can share art whenever you feel like. There's no pressure of, oh, you have to follow this and this and this. And I've met so many people actually, like, because I like painting with gouache paint. It's like a watercolor but opaque. I landed on some group and I started sharing my work there, and this thing has so many people from around the world.
Yeah.
And they would respond well to my work, and there was that community aspect of you talk, you communicate, you make friends from that. Something that you will not find via Instagram.
That's what I was going to say. Instagram is, I don't know, it's I don't like, really understand.
Oh, that looks nice. Walk away. Let them guys. And you walk away.
It's a place for the people that know how to slay, I think, mostly.
Because you're actually competing with models and photographers who literally can
thank you so much.
Create content every day. You're creating something from nothing. You can't be putting out something every day. What do you do when you're not feeling okay? Because every piece you put out, you get drained. That's why some artists on those platforms could go off for like 2 years. And it comes back after some because it drains. Because it's like a machine. They want to take and take and take. You just keep on giving until you're like... So it feels like you are in a casino. You work hard, put in poster pic. The views are like those chips of, I've scored big. Multiple, like I've gotten 400
people. But I think that's how social media works generally at some point.
It feels like. But I don't feel that pressure when it comes to Facebook. I can't.
I think Facebook has sort of built a community that can relate with you as a human being.
Beyond
just an artist. So thank you so much for giving us your time.
You're most welcome.
Do enjoy the rest of 2022. You'll find more reason to come back to the podcast and share your knowledge.
I have
about
to.
All the things that you've experienced in life.
I have to. Because, I like having such conversations. They are rare. They're really rare to have.
Yeah.
Whereby you talk about where you started from, and the way it links with the mental health bit of it. More so when you're in a country or a society whereby the mental health is like
novel area. But I think we're starting to embrace it slowly by slowly.
Yeah, I'm glad for such podcasts because they are creating that awareness.
Thank you for saying yes to the invite.
You're most welcome.
My takeaway from this episode is that you need to go past the rules for you to be exceptional. Thank you for tuning into another episode of Hash Time with Navguzi Chwanuka. If you loved what you heard, make sure you subscribe to Hash Time with Navguzi Chwanuka in your podcast platform of choice and share it with your friends. Let them know that this is a podcast for every other person in the millennial age. Feel free to also share your insights about what connected with you on social media and be sure to tag us. We are at Hashtime with Navguzi Chwanuka on Facebook and Instagram, and on Twitter, our handle is at htnkpodcast. You can also reach us on our email, htnkpodcast@gmail.com. I really look forward to hearing from you. Until the next episode, make sure that you go past the rules.